Smoak Horner went to Marshall High School in the Houston area. He played at Baylor and has been a part of the show a couple of different times. He started a new business. We're going to get to that. He's been in the coaching profession as well. And Mo Porter joins us on Sikkim 365 Radio and 365 Sports. When I contacted Mo Porter earlier today, I said, I want to get your feedback. We're going to get some former players on this week to look at not only what the defense is doing and what they've been and who they are, but also what they've done with that offensive line with Eric Mateos and the running game with Abram Smith and company. Mo, thanks for your time. Hope you had a great Christmas and also a happy New Year's weekend. When you watch this offensive line now, what do you see?
When I watch the offensive line now, I see a different type of physicality. You know, they're a different type of O-line than we once were back in the day, especially the Browns era. We're more of a fast type of physical team, but now they're a really true ground-and-pound, in-your-face, smash-mouth, try to run you over, talk a little trash till you get, but doing it the right way. Now, that's just something that I used to love watching, especially like seeing the guys that was freshmen when I was a senior, seeing them just transition into what they is now is just amazing to watch.
When you look at the guys and where they were 2 years ago, a year ago, and now, what do you think was the thing that gelled it all together that made them, other than a scheme change, that made them be, you know, what they are physically right now?
It's just the players up front. It's just the guys inside the room. I feel like that was just the biggest difference. Them guys finally found them a legit five that was going to be with each other throughout the whole season, and they gelled together really well. And you can just see like how they do their different combo blocks, how much they actually train and practice together and trust one another up front.
Mo, your Baylor career came to a close in 2017. As we know, there's a lot of things up in the air at the time. For you to see what, you know, Matt Rhule would do and then obviously left, but then Dave Aranda to come in and to see, you know, all the ups and the downs over the years to now Sugar Bowl champs, Big 12 champs, 12 wins, first time in school history. As somebody who helped lay the foundation and help get Baylor through some of the bumpy ride, I mean, just how much did that mean to you as a former player?
I mean, it means a lot. It really means a lot, like I said, just watching how the guys transition from being snot-nosed freshmen to being active grown men, you know, doing the stuff right the right way. And being able to transition between two separate coaches. People don't understand how much that really affects people. You know, when a coach that came and sat on your couch actually leaves and goes off and doing something else, and to bring a new person in that don't know nothing about you, and you got to trust him, he got to trust you for the most success. And I feel like those guys did a great job with transition. You know, last year was a down year, but I don't really hold that against them because of COVID. They didn't have much time to be with each other, you know, all that stuff. So when they got together this year, I feel like they had a good game plan with each other. They came out and they said, we're going to trust Coach Aranda. We're going to believe in everything he got going on. We're going to get back to the mountaintop. And they did just that.
You have seen the transition before. You've experienced that. How difficult can that be?
It's very, very difficult, especially if, like, the coach that you, like I said, the coach that sat on your couch and recruited you just left, it really hurts you a different type of way. But if you were prepared for it and you trust the next coach that's coming in, it's not going to be as hard as long as you trust the coach that's coming in behind them. And I feel like those guys really, really, really trusted Coach Aranda this year and believed in his system, and it all paid off in the end.
What do you think of Coach Aranda's demeanor and his intellect and everything that kind of comes across?
He's actually, people might find him as mean, but I actually find him as funny because I've been around a team and I can see that's not him all the time, but that's the persona he likes to put out there. This very serious type of guy, so it's funny. But I actually like the way how his knowledge of the game just expands. Like, his things that he says, and I watched a couple of interviews, I was like, man, I never thought of it that way. And how he, you know, just his charisma with stuff. You know, he's a calm, cool, collected guy. He's not going to be too much all over your face. He's going to be a grown man about the situation. He's going to hold you accountable for your actions. And when it's time for him to turn up with you, he's going to turn up with you.
Mo, what were your impressions of Xavier Newman-Johnson? He was a true freshman coming in when you were your senior. He's been through a lot throughout his time, but, I mean, now he's at a point where he announced, you know, obviously his career's over, but he went out as a Big 12 champ and a Sugar Bowl champ. I mean, just the growth that you saw from that young man over the last few years to ending up where he has now.
That's my guy right there, Ace. You know, me and him, we go way back. When he was getting recruited, I was the person, you know, walking him around, giving him a lot of business and stuff, giving him a couple of pointers of what he should do with his commitment and all that type of stuff. And just see his growth. We used to be roommates, actually, on the day before the game. So we just sit there and talk about all this stuff. I try to put him on games, say, hey, right now you get to have fun, but you, at a certain time, you're going to have to start taking this stuff. You know, you got to be very serious, because after a while, you're going to be the head dog. You're going to be the person that's going to be taking over. You're going to be the person that got to tell everybody what to do. So to see him transition from a freshman, you know, he didn't really believe in himself a lot either when he was a freshman. You know, I used to have to talk to him. I'm like, bro, you got it. Like, you might not be getting the playing time that you want right now, but just trust it. Just trust the process. You're going to do it. And then he ended up starting, Oklahoma my senior year, and he held that starting spot down for the until now. So he finally graduated. So just see his growth is just amazing. You know, that's like a guy I actually look to, like his little brother. Like, me and him had a lot of one-on-one conversations with each other. So I know what he actually came from, how his mindset changed from a freshman to what his mindset is now.
Yeah, and the coaches said, and even Aranda said, there's been a lot of, like, deep personal conversations. And, you know, he didn't get into details, but he said there's a lot of things, you know, confidence and stuff like that that Xavier had to work through. So just the growth off the field, I mean, transitioning into how important that is in the way you play on the field, right? I mean, that comes into it. It's not just, you know, go out there and you're talented and you work hard, but there was a lot of personal stuff that he's grown up and changed along the way as well.
Oh, yeah, he's definitely changed along the way. There's a lot of ways. It's just a blessing to see him just grow up in so many different ways, and to see how him become a man now instead of a little kid.
All right, so I want to, you know, this program, we know how bad they were for about almost 20 years, no bowl game for 16 or 17. Coach Briles builds them up. He, of course, then leaves in 2016. You were a part of that. They recruited you, that staff. You were at Navarro prior to that. Then you had Matt Rhule. Now there's Dave Aranda. And Mo, it might be me, I don't know, we've talked about it among the three of us, is that I see a lot of former players who were a part of even the Coach Briles teams, and then, of course, with Matt Rhule. I see a lot of them starting to get more involved again in Baylor football. Do you get that impression as well?
I mean, yeah, because, you know, a lot of people, especially like the Briles guy, a lot of them felt like they wasn't wanted around on the campus and stuff. You know how everything was going on, just like a lot of bad blood. I'm gonna be honest, like a lot of people felt like they got rubbed the wrong way. You know how everything was handled. A lot of people just didn't want to be associated. Not saying they didn't love Baylor and everything, but just felt like they was getting done wrong. So a lot of guys, especially like Brian Nance, who was works on the staff now, he's trying to tell the players like it's not like that. Come around, like they want you guys around. Like it's multiple times we got a group message between a lot of former players that he tells them, hey, come up here. Like, it's okay for y'all to come up here. Like, let it go. Like, what happened in the past. They understand where everything went on. Some stuff could have been handled different, but just the team. You got blood on this field somewhat. Support your brothers. Like, everybody doing this for the old heads. You know, these young cats, they watched us play. They don't know much, but they used to watch when they was in middle school, high school. They saw those guys on TV. So to see them come back, somebody they looked up to, that makes them even go harder, you know. After the games, some of the games I went to, and I go inside the locker room and see the players, like, they didn't expect to see me. I feel like I'm an afterthought, but when I walk in, it's all love all over again. Like, they look up to us. Like I said, those were guys that were freshmen. We were seniors.
I love how Mo, at 27, 28 years old, can call himself an old head.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I'm old. My body's already fixed.
Hey, you brought up Brian Nance. What's it been like to see him become the coach that he's becoming and you know, the guy behind the scenes and in front of the scenes sometimes as well? I mean, just promoting the team, but also all the stuff that he's doing on staff. I mean, what's it been like to watch Brian's journey?
Brian's journey is crazy, man. You know, me and Brian go way, way, way back. Mm-hmm. You know, we know a couple people from way back in high school. So me and Brian have been knowing each other for a long time. So to see his growth, as how he's matured into the role that he has to play, he had to understand what his role was at Baylor. And his role is to, like, bring all the people back. His role is to promote the team. So just to see him and his growth, especially where he's coming from, you know, his difficulties with him getting put on probation to school, not being able to play football, you know, all his injuries and stuff, our bad senior year. So for him to just keep his head down and stay focused is just amazing to watch. And I know his future is bright, because anybody that get Brian on their staff, they team success always going to do better, because he's I don't want to say it too yet, but he's like he got some what a Coach McGuire inside him, to where he's always fired up about the situation. He's always promoting good stuff, and you know, he's just happy all the time. He's just happy where he is, and like, you know, things could always be better, but he's just happy to see that he's happy overcoming everything he's overcame.
Yeah, and you know what's happening is he's becoming now really good on the recruiting trail. He's won some of those battles. He's gotten his first commitments, and it's kind of given him even more confidence. Can you see that, because of all he's been through, he played the game, that he would be great to talk to as far as inside of a living room of a mother, a father, a grandmother, whoever else?
Yeah, Brian is a great person. You know, he's from Buffalo, you know, a rough background, so he can relate to kids in that way. He had to go to Hargraves because of academics, so yep. He can relate to kids that way. He had the red shirt almost twice. Like I said, he had the red shirt when he came to Baylor, and he had to sit out another year because of academics again. So he understands the struggle that a lot of kids go through. He understands that, hey, if I can do it, you can do it too. And that's a lot of kids need to understand that at Baylor, you're going to be loved, you're going to be pushed, you're going to be challenged, and being answered is a product of that. Being loved, being pushed, and being challenged, that the school is always going to have your back no matter what.
You know, it's great to hear from you. I know we're going to get to your primetime security and what you're doing now. It's pretty interesting. Your job was to protect the quarterback or the running backs, and now your job is protecting other people. Tell us about primetime security.
Primetime security, me and my friends back home from high school, we always used to discuss about stuff we wanted to do in the future. But a lot of people was waiting for me to get done playing football because that was like, they didn't want to bother me with business ventures knowing that I was focused on playing football. So after I finally was retired from playing ball, we sat there, you know, we talked a lot, different business ventures and what we can go through. And we all figured like, okay, this security would be the best way. So me and a couple of my friends, we just, you know, we started off a whim. It was no experience, no nothing. We all just said, this is what we want to do. So we sat back for a while, listened, learned, had actual advice on how to start businesses. And we actually started in 2020, but we all know how that went. As we was going up, 2020 shut everything down. So once that shut down, I had to get into coaching. I had to make some type of way, I had to make some type of money, so I had to get into coaching. And I used that coaching money to, you know, fuel and build capital for the business. You know, we put it all in. Everything we did, we put it all into this company. So I was able to quit in the summer and do this full time. You know, we've been doing this. We got two branches, one up in Dallas where I reside and one down in Houston where my friends reside. You know, it's just been on an up and up. Like, this is what I do full time. We got about four or five contracts in the Texas area looking to build up more. I was trying to open clientele. We got different, you know, personal clients, you know, promotions, party groups, which it's constantly growing. It's just something that I'm very proud of because I never in my life thought I would be an actual business owner. Like, this is something that I still wake up and just in awe that this is all just coming to fruition.
That's awesome, man. You can hear the excitement in your voice. I mean, you tell how much it means. See, that's really, really cool, Mo. That's awesome, man. And best of luck moving forward with all of that. Yeah, definitely need to get some info to, like, we could tweet out something on that and put that out as well.
Yeah, but just text it to me, Mo, and I'll put it up on Twitter. Yeah.
Hey, all right, no problem.
Yeah. Mo, Abram Smith is now the Baylor record holder for single-season rushing yards. He was brand new in your final year as well. He's another baby-faced freshman. I know he redshirted that year, but, I mean, my gosh, man, you talked about the physicality of the O-line, but to see what Abram did this year, his first year back at running back, just how incredible was that to watch that unfold, and then to see, you know, how he capped it off in the Sugar Bowl?
I mean, it was amazing to watch. Honestly, speaking about Abram, when he first came in, Abram was one of our best running backs in his freshman year. He ran as hard as he run now. He was running like that at the age of 17. But unfortunately, I think it was a spring practice. I don't know if it was spring or summer, one of the fall camps, I don't know. But he tore his ACL, and that's what stopped him because he was actually getting, like, a lot of playing time. Like, Abram was very, like, as a true freshman coming in, running over guys that were seniors and vets. So he's always been a hard runner. It's just that once he tore his ACL, I think he tore it again after that, and then that's when he just started trying to play linebacker, so, you know, just to get on the field. We had a loaded backfield already with all those running backs, so he just wanted to get on the field and play linebacker. So when I heard him switch back to running back, I was like, oh, it's going to get real. He's back in his natural position. So I loved, like, seeing him run. Like, it felt like I was in 2017 watching him in spring practice all over again.
You sound happy, Mo. You sound at peace, and it seems like you got through that tough year, the transition. You sound about as happy as we've heard you.
Yeah, man. I mean, things can always be better, but yeah, I'm definitely happy with life is right now. Like I said, like, a couple years ago, I never would have thought that my life would be where it is right now. You know, I do things that I never thought I would be able to do. I go out. I don't have a regular job. I work for myself. I'm able to take care of my family. I can, you know, send money to people in need. You know, I help go out, do the homeless. Like, I do what I want to do, and that's just something I always felt like I should do, but I always tried to play football. But once that was over with, I finally got to what I really wanted to do, and that's be a business owner. Like, I like to be my own boss, and not narcissistically speaking, but I don't like being told what to do because I kind of feel like I'm a lot smarter than the people.
Hey, I got to feel that way too sometimes. Yeah. I relate to that.
Hey, text me the link and I will put it up immediately. Mo Porter, thank you, buddy. Appreciate your time.
No problem. You guys have a great day.
I wanted to do that this week, and we'll do it just because I think it's important, and I think we have seen kind of a shift. And it didn't, not just this year, but when they went to the Sugar Bowl even a couple of years ago, because of how a lot of the former, the era of Art Briles to Matt Rhule to Dave Aranda, and I saw a lot of former players. They love it. I mean, Bryce Petty's been all in from day one, and Seth Russell and people like that. But, yeah, it'll be interesting if you ever see the Kendall Wrights and others start to get back on this ship as well. And we have seen some of that. And I, you know, even Ahmad Dixon, during the darkest hours of his life, he was talking about even with Matt Rhule and that team in 2019.
Yeah, Matt Rhule did a good job and, you know, kind of slowly but surely bringing some of those guys back kind of into the mix. You know, I know Corey Coleman started to kind of come around a little bit with Matt Rhule. But, you know, I think the thing with Matt Rhule was just like there's always that uncertainty of how long is this really going to last?
Yep.
Is this really something to, like, invest in, or is this something that we get invested in and then – you know, typical Baylor, it's gone, you know, and then he moves on. And there was that question once he moved on. But I think now you look at Dave Aranda and the results and just the culture of the program and the health of it, and you have guys like Brian Nance behind the scenes who know what's what. He's been through all those. I mean, he's been through every single regime. He's probably the only guy that has been, actually, in some way, shape, or form, or one of the very few. And I think that's great. I mean, they need to get these guys involved. Every other program touts their former players, and Baylor's got plenty they can tout as well. And, you know, some of them have been back. And, you know, Bryce Petty's been as involved, it seems like, as ever, as far as talking about the team. And Seth Russell's around. And you got Big Mo. And you've got, you know, others. But, yeah, there's always more that can come join the party. And the more, the merrier. But it's good to hear that Brian's bridging that gap. I think that's really important. And how could you not be a former player looking at Saturday night and not have a smile on your face, knowing what all has occurred over the last few years and the ups and downs? Just an incredible moment for those guys, I would imagine the same as it was for the current players.
Well, and look, I think part of that also, like, when you're young and all this stuff just happens to you, you're probably trying to be loyal to the coaches at first. And then I think when you realize the coaches aren't going to begrudge you going back to your school and supporting it, because where else are you going to go? I mean, that was you. Like Mo said, you've got blood on that field out there. Like, you did that for that. So that's, you know, bygones be bygones and move on. And, yeah, we've seen a lot of the older players around. Look, a couple years ago, that Oklahoma game, seeing some of the guys. Look, seeing a couple guys I never thought I would see again. And that's a big deal.
You're right. Because it can be a scar that sometimes you don't want to peel it back, or you don't want to ever – you always want to look at it, remind yourself – go ahead.
I just think it's different now. I mean, time's passed. I mean, it's been like 6-7 years at this point. I mean, what are you going to hold?
And some guys get older and they get more.
Yeah, just things change. Life mellow. Changes and other people come in and new relationships are built and all that. And you know, obviously, again, credit to Brian Nance for helping do that. But it's great to hear Mo as excited as he is. You know, he didn't play it down this year, but he sure as hell helped lay the foundation because, you know, he had some incredible info on Abram as a freshman running back and just his insight into guys like Xavier Newman Johnson and the growth over the last 5 years for him. So, yeah, great to hear Mo. Great to hear that he's doing well. And we definitely need to, you know, push out a tweet on his business. And best of luck to him with that venture.
By the way, the chat.